Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for being with us for this very special occasion. We want to come together today, not only to enjoy this extraordinary interview that Coach Taylor will have with Ms. Early, but also on behalf of the University of Georgia to thank Ms. Early for the extraordinary work that she put in to writing this book and telling her story so that it is now a part of the history of the University of Georgia and the history of this state. So I would ask all of you to join me in thanking Ms. Early for all she means to this institution. This is obviously a special day for UGA, so we look forward to the interview. Thank you.
President Moorhead, thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you everyone for joining us today. I am so humbled and excited to be a part of such an incredible conversation with Ms. Early, our history maker, regarding her autobiography, The Quiet Trailblazer, the journey as the first Black graduate of the University of Georgia. Our goal for each person is to learn something about Ms. Early and her experience of being the first at UGA. To our virtual audience, enjoy the chat, talk to each other, and share active feedback to what you're hearing from our conversation. Use the question and answer button to submit questions for our Quiet Trailblazer to answer. For our live audience, please submit your questions in the basket located at the entrance of Mailer Hall. We will try to get to as many of them as we can during our hour together with the help of our student ambassador, Jasmine Gresham. Ms. Early, thank you for your presence today and for sharing your story with us. Now, let's get ready to dive into this conversation. First, why did you write this book? And could you give us an overview of what readers can look forward to?
I wrote this book because I felt that there needed to be a written account. Although I've spoken on campus and off campus many, many times, there needed to be a written account of my time at UGA. And it's part of UGA's history, and I'm part of UGA's history too. And for such a long time, I was not known. And of course, there's still some people who say, well, I didn't know about you, which is okay. But that gets better every year. And I hope that after people have been able to read the book, that they will understand that I wrote the book for historical purposes. It's really a kind of book that could be read, I guess, by almost any age other than little small kids, because I tried to use language that was accessible to all, because I wanted people to be able to read it easily. And it's not very long either. I think about as much was taken out of it as was kept in, which is why we have editors to help you. But I think there's enough that tells a story of my life, and it does tell the story of my life from my birth until now.
So let's talk about your life a little bit. You know, your father served in the military during World War I. He also owned a restaurant, the Tuxedo coffee shop.
Right.
Your mom was a school teacher in Monroe before moving to Atlanta with your father. And then after he owned a restaurant, he was the manager for Lincoln Golf Club. Talk about just you and your brother growing up in that environment, all of the things you had access to, and what that did for you in terms of how you were able to sneak across to the library while they were at the restaurant and managing the books at the restaurant, and just how it opened your eyes to so many things and just the family dynamic that you guys had.
Well, I think it was sort of unusual. Everybody didn't have a father who owned a restaurant. I can't say that I grew up poor, because we never got everything that we wanted, but we certainly had everything we needed. And the thing that we needed the most was the love and the support of parents who encouraged us to do our best. But growing up in Atlanta, there was no way you could escape the racism. Mm-hmm. And I was very aware of it from an early childhood. I did not like being made to feel like a second-class citizen. I didn't understand why I couldn't drink the water from the white fountain rather than from the colored fountain. And the water wasn't colored, so I didn't understand what. But there were a lot of things, of course. Many of you are too young to, and you certainly are too young to understand that you could not try on clothes in a store. You had to just look at it and decide if it would fit you. If you took it home and it didn't fit, you just were out of luck. You had to sit at the back of the bus or the streetcar, because we had streetcars back in those days. You had to sit at the back of the store when purchasing shoes. You couldn't go to downtown restaurants. You could only go to Black-owned restaurants. You couldn't go to the main library. And that's why I spent my time at the Auburn Avenue Library, which was the only one that was open to Blacks at the time. And of course, we didn't call ourselves Blacks then. I have to go back. We were Negroes, or colored. But I spent a lot of time at the library because I was paid to stay out of the way. And that was a good way of earning money. But my father, though he only went to through elementary school, he was wise enough to open a bank account for my brother and me when we were just babies. And we would have to take a portion of the money that you get when you're
a kid. Your allowance.
Your allowance. Mm-hmm. We had to take a portion of that every month with him to the First National Bank, now the Wells Fargo Bank, to put into our savings account. And that came in handy. I thought that was a neat idea. So he was not formally educated, but he was a very astute man and a wonderful compliment to my mother, who was very quiet, but very strong. And I think I inherited some of both of their personalities.
Wow. So we'll talk about that savings account later, because it was how you were able to buy your first clarinet when you finally were able to be in the band in high school. So we'll come back to that story. But, you know, you talk about living in the era of Jim Crow. I don't know that from personal experience, but I'm from Mississippi, and my mom, she'll kill me for telling her age, but she was born in 1942. So I've heard several similar stories. So I really resonated with your book and just your life story. Talk about your experience at the Fox Theater and other places in your childhood, and also segue from there to, I try to wrap my mind around, you graduate from high school in 1952, and as a graduation gift, your mom sends you to New York to visit your stepsister Miriam for 2 weeks. And as I'm sitting there reading that, I'm thinking and picturing you in the front of the train car with your luggage, because they won't let you store it. There's a separate seating for white people. You can't have any, there's not a place for you to lay down. You're not served food, so you have to pack your own food for that 12-hour trip. And then you get to New York, and Miriam is a gracious host. For 2 weeks, you go to Broadway plays, you go to the Central Park, the Art Museum, the Public Library, you eat in restaurants right next to Caucasian people, and several other things. And then you have to get back on the train and come back to the Jim Crow South. Talk about that experience.
Yes, New York was like a different world, because I had never had the opportunity to sit in a restaurant with whites. I had not been to an art museum before, because I guess Atlanta had one, but we weren't. None of the cultural events were open to Blacks, except for the nightclubs. And of course, we had some wonderful people who came to the nightclubs, but I wasn't allowed to go, but I knew about them. But it was such a difference. And I think I said in my autobiography that I didn't understand this big difference between the North and the South. But I did understand the fact that the Mason-Dixon line, the line that divided the slave states from the free states. It was real. It was real. And it was unreal to go from one reality to another. But as a 17-year-old, I made that transition, but hated to go back. And one of the things that I promised myself was that I would return to New York, and I did.
And several other places that we'll,
yes,
we'll talk about. So, you know, early education, you go to E.P. Johnson Elementary School, and you credit that with being a pivotal part of your lifelong participation in music and music education. EP was the first elementary school built for Blacks in Atlanta. And while you're there, you are introduced to the Ethiopia at the Bar of Justice,
yes,
by Miss Jean Willis. And in the book, you say, that pageant signaled my awakening to the many contributions of the Black race. Its central message made a powerful impact on my youthful life. It also presaged my future as a civil rights activist. In a sense, it started me on my journey to UGA, though I didn't know it at that time. Talk about how this play, this pageant, had an impact on your life and gave you empowerment and self-esteem.
Well, let me say, first of all, although we grew up, my brother was 18 months older than me. We grew up in segregated Atlanta. Our parents didn't teach us to dislike or hate or treat white people differently or to treat them unkindly, even though they knew what we were all living through. They simply said that if we worked hard and if we did well in school, whatever our potential was, if we worked hard, we could achieve it. And they encouraged us to do just that. Now, that was difficult as a child to understand. And my mother had only gone through high school. She was teaching, although she didn't have a teaching certificate, because they thought that since she was the top student in her high school class, that she could teach younger students, and she did. But one of the things that she taught me was that if you continue to learn to read as well as you do, that reading will take you places that you could never imagine. And I didn't really know what she meant at the time. Now, this is not in my book, but this is what she told us. But I believe that she had something there, because when I see young people today, I think if they could involve themselves in the written word, if they could involve themselves with reading, in traveling vicariously to other lands, in learning to love animals or to learn travel or places, they could be a lot further along than they get. And many of our students drop out of school because they get behind. And if we could just somehow, I wish we had a pill that we could give to kids, talking about the vaccine now, but if we could give them a pill to make them love to read, we could solve some of the problems that we have. But it was difficult. Ethiopia at the Bar of Justice was a pageant that depicted the white race as opposition, the Black race as Ethiopia. And our teacher did not teach it to us in a sense that that means that you're supposed to hate. The whole purpose was to show opposition said that Ethiopia had done nothing to further the cause of civilization in America. And Ethiopia then had all these people to come, the 14th, the 15th Amendment, slaves, people from the various wars, professions, women, the church, all of these came to sing the praises of Ethiopia and tell what she had contributed to America's growth. And I'd never heard this before. So I thought, you know, this is really something. I've been reading all these things, as my mom told me, but I can't read in the textbook because it's not there. The textbooks don't tell us about these contributions. They don't tell us about Crispus Attucks. So when we presented the play, and by the way, you'll have to read the book to find out what happened. I'm not going to tell you. We presented the play at our school, and I was so excited about it that when I finished elementary school and went on to high school and I joined another church, I introduced the same pageant to the teens, fellow teens at my church. Because it wasn't just me who didn't know about the contributions of Black Americans. Many of us didn't. And even today, they're talking about the critical race. Anyway, that argument is going on, but the problem is that if you don't know your history, if you don't know what has happened, you can't improve upon it because you don't know where you've been. So we must know our history in order to move forward. And that's what I was doing.
Amen. Goodness. And then having that awakening really started your journey into lighting a fire for you to affect change, be the change. You just quietly went about everywhere you went, making history. You know, I look at you writing the school song for Turner High School. And now, even though Turner High School no longer exists, every time there's an alumni function, they sing a school song that you wrote. Mm-hmm. I think back to, again, you telling me your father had no more than a third grade education. Your mom finished high school. But the things that they instilled in you and your brother, they were far beyond their time. Beyond their time.
That's true. They resonated with us in many ways. We were a family. My father was not, unlike Chick-fil-A, we did not have work at the restaurant on Sundays. Of course, the library wouldn't have been open on Sundays either. But we had a business, but we operated as a family unit. We went to church together, Allen Temple Church. My former student who came with me today, we were talking about Allen Temple. It was in Summerhill where I lived, but now it's on the southwest side of town. But at any rate, those days resonate with me, and we presented that same play at Mount Vernon Baptist Church, which was where I went after we left Summerhill. But I think one of the things that is not really understood about my coming to UGA, I am known on this campus basically as the person who got the first degree. But in order to get the first degree, I had to get in and I had to matriculate during 1961 because I don't think there's any university of any worth that would give you a degree for being there only 1 year. So I was here in 61. When Charlene and Hamilton had to go through, well, actually they had to go through a lot just when they came to campus with people shouting 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate. And then on January the 11th, having a riot, that sparked something in me. I had been quiet all the time at home, wondering what is it that we can do? And some of us might be asking that question today because we have a similar situation, but what can I do to help integration come about? And I looked and I thought, they are putting these students out of school, suspending them when they should be suspending the ones who were causing the riot. But that wasn't what happened. So yes, all of the things that happened in my childhood propelled me in a path that ended up with my saying to my mother, I'm going to transfer from the University of Michigan to the University of Georgia. And of course, she was not happy about my decision. She said, are you crazy? I said, no, but things are not going to change until we do something about it. And I know I can't march on the picket line, but I can go to school. I've been a good student. And this is my path. And I took it. But a lot of people think that I just waltzed in. That is not what happened. UGA was still trying to defy the 1954 Supreme Court ruling. They didn't want me anymore. They had wanted Charlene and Hamilton. And they had even installed a lot of rules, new rules, the Board of Regents, that said that if you were over 25, you couldn't enter. Well, a lot of the administrators didn't like that because they knew that that would limit some of the students that they might have. Well, after they had tried everything, first they looked at my grades. They couldn't argue with those. Then they, well, of course, I had to go to the courthouse to get my citizenship verified. And then they did a investigative report.
With the FBI, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think it was the GBI, but nobody really signed as who did it. But it was a GBI or FBI type report. They only did three. They did one for Charlene. They did one for Hamilton. They did one for me. They were looking for, as Lonnie King, my former E.P. Johnson schoolmate said, they were looking for dirt, and they didn't find it. And so then I had a very unpleasant conference with Danner, who was the registrar. And I won't go into that because this is a happy day and I don't want to think about some of those things. But things that they would not have asked any other student, particularly a white student. And they had exhausted all of the things they tried to keep me out. Now, mind you, I applied in January. And by this time, after I had gotten, when I did the interview with Danner, that was in April. And I had to make my own plans to come down for that because they didn't invite me, but it was a requirement. So then they turned it over to the officials at the state capitol. And there was a newspaper article that stated that the officials, now who would they be? They would be the governor and maybe his cabinet, and it would be the House of Representatives and senators. I don't know who was there, but they reluctantly decided that they had to admit Miss Early based on her good teaching record and academic record. They reluctantly decided, because if they failed to do so, Judge Boodle would probably admit her and issue an injunction for not following his ruling. You see, his ruling was when Charlene and Hamilton were admitted that any qualified Negro should be admitted. Well, they got a third person and she was qualified, but they didn't want her. But that's the reason why I want people to know that it was not, I didn't just waltz in the doors and I was not welcomed any more than anyone else. And I was the only student, black student on campus in 61. So all of the vitriol that people had to throw, they threw it at me. But it didn't bother me because, except when they threw rocks, I threw them back. It didn't bother me because I was self-selected. Nobody asked me to come to UGA. No one asked me or encouraged me. My mother said, no, you don't need to go down there. But I felt this was something that needed to be done. No one had entered the graduate school. And so that's why I came. I did not come to be the first to get a degree. There was no way I could have known that I would even last, let alone get the first degree. I came to help desegregate the university and assist Charlene and Hamilton in doing so.
Yeah, you said that you were ignored at times, you had unpleasant conversations, but then I've heard you say it put the steel on your back.
It did.
That you told yourself this is something you asked for, you made this decision, so get over it and deal with it.
That's right.
But it wasn't pleasant.
Right.
Talk about arriving on campus and nothing being prepared for you once you got there.
Well, I think it was sort of humorous then. When I reflect on it now, after going through registration, which was a little unsettling because I didn't know what to expect. And of course, I just didn't know what to expect. The point where I was to get my housing, I had to wait because they didn't have a housing card made out for me. And I wondered, do they think I wasn't coming, or did they think I was going to room off campus? Because as a graduate student, of course, I could have done that. But no, I wanted to be involved in the campus. That's why I came. So I waited, and I was finally given a room card. And it was the same room that had housed Charlene before she left going back home.
The Black Suite.
Yes.
Let's go back a little bit and talk about, because you've always had a quiet resolve. You've always been very sure about what it is you wanted to do. And so when you were at, in high school, you want to be a part of the band. And you were told that you probably should be in the chorus instead. And then when you finally have an opportunity to be in the band, they want you to play the tuba because you could read the music. And so you declined, became a part of Sisters of Song instead.
Yes.
And then you finally get an opportunity to be in the band at Turner High School. Talk about that experience, how it really, and then as you were chosen as conductor, how you knew you wanted to have a career in music and music education. And I have to add that she was also a high school basketball player. I have to make sure that we all know that. She quit after she cut her lip and couldn't play the clarinet anymore, but she was briefly a part of the basketball team. But talk about being in the, yes, finally having your opportunity to be in the band, and how you purchased that clarinet with the money from the savings account that your father started for you.
My dream to be in the band started when I was in elementary school, when we had a big festival at the City Auditorium, and I was playing in a rhythm band. I was 7 years old in the third grade, and I thought that was juvenile. You know, it was simple. But I saw these kids sitting over playing real instruments, and I wanted to do that. And when I asked our supervisor why I couldn't, she said that E.P. Johnson didn't have enough money to pay for an itinerant band teacher. And I thought, oh, but I'm going to be in the band. So when I went to Washington High School, that was my second high school, I asked the band director if I could be in the band, and he wanted me to play the tuba. And I said, no, I don't want to play an instrument that big. But he needed a tuba player, and you know, it wasn't what you wanted to play, it was what I need. He needed a tuba player, but he wasn't going to have me because I didn't want to play a tuba. So when I went to Turner High School, I talked with the band director, and he said, oh, sure, what instrument do you want to play? Which was the right question, by the way. And I told him the clarinet. And he said, well, I don't have any more clarinets that belong to the school. Do you think your parents can buy you one? I said, well, the only parent I have is my mom, but we'll see. And so I talked with her, and she said, well, you have money in the bank. That's why you saved your money, your allowance. So go find yourself a clarinet, and we'll buy it. So I bought a first line buffet, which is a French model clarinet. And I was as happy as a bug in a rug. Because finally, after going through all of these years through the 11th grade, I was in the band, and I was playing the clarinet, the instrument that I loved. And when I went to college, the head of the music department told me, I think that's what you're referencing, that women don't teach band. They teach chorus, general music. And I said, well, I did my student teaching in both band and chorus, and I taught a class in general music. Maybe I can teach both. But he never, see, women's rights were not, this was not the talk of the town then. So I just had that streak, and I always tried to do it, though, in a way that was not being confrontational or being obnoxious, as some students are.
You can disagree without being disagreeable.
Disagreeable, correct, yes. That has always worked for me, and it perhaps doesn't work for everyone, but I find that a carrot is better than a stick.
So you talked about your college days. After high school, you have several opportunities to go to college, and you choose Clark College because it is co-ed and you want that experience. And your journal entry after the first week of freshman orientation, it is so profound. But here's an excerpt from it. It says, thank God I am an American. an American who can go forward, not as a Negro, but as a true American citizen, to greater heights and to the pinnacle of success. Tonight, I pray a fervent prayer for the freshman class of Clark College and the freshman classes all over the world, that they may dedicate themselves to the task of finishing this college course of 4 years, and if possible, return back to help their people who are not as fortunate as they. Mold themselves into true citizens of the United States and of America, so that someday the Negro race will not be called Negro and the Caucasian race called white, but all will be united together in one race, the human race, having differences only in pigment of skin, texture of hair, and having this in common, a citizen of the United States of America. How often did you refer back to that during your time at Georgia with everything that you went through?
I never did, but I'm proud to say that. How many of you know what a spiral-bound notebook looks like, the one with the little blue cover? Well, that's what I wrote it in, and it's right here at Georgia. It's in the Russell Library, that where I actually wrote that. I was 17 years of age, and I never referred back to it, but I thought then what I thought when I came to UGA, that we are a human race. You know, we're not white, we're not black, we're not purple or yellow. We are humans. And to have had that insight at the age of 17, I really don't know how that came to be, but it was handwritten and it is here. And I think that though that if we could all embrace that kind of philosophy in terms of living, because my friends are black, they're white, they're Thai, they're whatever, because I choose friends because of their character rather than the color of their skin. And I think that this is the best way to go about it in terms of living, because it makes you a happier person. But you're right. I had that determination, and apparently I lived through it, because I was just a freshman in college then. But 4, 5, 6 years later, I would be pushing at the doors of the University of Georgia.
So leading into your senior year of college, you have an opportunity to go to New York and be a counselor, a music counselor at a camp. And that provided you an opportunity, again, to be in a city in the North that was a lot more diverse in its thinking. And you had the opportunity to work with people of other races. How did that, again, help grow your experiences and prepare you for not only what you did at Georgia, but your career as a music educator?
It really did. I almost didn't get to go, but I was in music and I was a junior at that time, and I wanted to try out my skills, what I had learned thus far at Clark. And I saw in 17 magazine, because I was always reading, they had a job opening for a MUSES counselor, MUSES, M-U-S-E-S, but it was for music. And I wrote a letter and applied for the job, and I got it. But my mother and the head of the music department didn't think that I was mature enough to go to all the way to New York. I don't know why, because I was 19 at the time, but anyway, they finally said okay. But it was wonderful because, you know, we didn't judge each other because of color. And they weren't looking for a black counselor or a white counselor. They were looking for someone who could teach music and lead the camp. And I was able to do that. And so I found that I could be on equal footing with people and not have to weigh how they thought or what they thought about me. And it was such a freedom, such a release. And that was very important to me. When I decided to go to the University of Georgia, I knew that there would be challenges, but I had had some challenges before. And I knew that if you have the perseverance, if you can just stick it out, and there was a person, you haven't asked about him, who helped me to do that. If you do, you can do almost anything. And that's what I tell young people today. You are capable of much more than you could even imagine. Because I'm sitting here today after having been forgotten by UGA for many, many years, over 30 years. And had it not been for Dr. Maurice Daniels, who, quote, discovered me in 1997, I wouldn't be sitting here. So there was a reason why things happened. And some of it was not of my own making. But I think I helped it along because I tried to live in such a way that I was not, that I was a blessing rather than a curse. I didn't come to Georgia to make, to do bad. I came to do good, to let people know that, you know, we're all the same. We are more alike than we are different. And it worked. And so I'm here today because of someone else. Dr. Daniels may be here today, but I am. Give it my hand. I am so indebted to him because he lifted me out of oblivion. I just was not known. He had worked on campus, but he had never heard my name in connection with desegregation. And the one thing that I disliked, nobody likes to be ignored, especially if you feel that you have done at least a little bit toward helping to make things better. But, you know, I lived with it for over 30 years, but then it happened, thanks to Dr. Maurice Daniels.
So you graduate from the University of Georgia and you receive a little bit of articles in the paper, notes from several people, and one of those notes is from Dr. Martin Luther King. I know he was a mentor of yours. You went to Ebenezer during your time while you were in grad school. Talk about what he said to you in that letter, how he encouraged you during your time here, and then speak a little bit to how your relationship with Georgia has changed since Mr. Daniels reintroduced you to the university in 1997 and you coming back in 2000 for your lecture.
Well, the first part was, yes, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was a champion to me. He was young. And, you know, I think the other night I was thinking about that song, Abraham, Martin, and John. This song goes, has anybody here seen my old friend Martin? Can you tell me where he's gone? He freed a lot of people. The good, they die young. I looked around and he's gone. But he was a big presence, though he was young. And he inspired me with his words of wisdom about brotherly love, sisterly love too, of nonviolence, of how we should treat each other. And he was sincere, and you could tell that he was sincere. He really meant it. He said that we should judge others by their character and not by the color of their skin. In his letter, you know, by the way, I can only quote one sentence. He said that you brought the state of Georgia and the nation closer to the American dream. That made me feel so good because that had been my intent, to try and help make this environment more appealing to people of color. You don't try to make anyone go to a school. But now the difference between then and now is almost indescribable. I mean, we wouldn't have had a black woman's winning basketball coach back then. We wouldn't have had a dean such as Dr. Daniels was. He was eventually appointed as dean of the School of Social Work. When he called me to ask, he was actually doing a documentary about Horace Ward, who was the first to try to enter University of Georgia and was not admitted. And when he was interviewing people, he talked with the wonderful attorney, Donald Hollowell. And he talked with Vernon Jordan, civil rights activist and lawyer who worked with Donald Hollowell. And he talked with Jesse Hill. And they told him that I was the first to get a degree at the University of Georgia. He called me and said, is this true? I was working at Clark Atlanta University at the time. And I said, yes, it's true. And then he did research. He didn't just take my word for it, but he found, I mean, there's plenty of evidence. He found that it was true. And then everything changed. I came to campus and I spoke to the GAPS student. And I just met the new GAPS president today. That's the Graduate and Professional Scholars. And they're a wonderful group of young people. They don't accept just Blacks, anyone who wants to join camp. But at any rate, after speaking with that group, everything just began to unfold. And I couldn't believe, I am so blessed, first of all, to be here at the age of 85. Secondly, to have all of the many awards, many recognitions given to me because of what I did. But I wasn't seeking that. I just wanted to be recognized as someone who helped make University of Georgia a place for all, a place that is desegregated so that we can feel comfortable. And I am so aware that there are students today who say that it's not as friendly as it ought to be. Well, maybe not, but it's a heck of a lot. And I almost said something else. It's a heck of a lot better than it was. And all we have to do, folk, is to look around at our nation, at our state, to know that there is no one place in heaven or hell where we can have perfect anything. That if students go to any school, there are going to be people who might not like them. There are going to be people who might not speak to them. And there might be even some professors who do the same. But if you have, that's what I call the steel in your bag. If you came to get a degree, University of Georgia is one of the best places you can come. It's, I think, this year 16th in
top 20 public
U.S. and World Report. It's a good place to be. And it's a good place for Black faculty. You see, when I was here, there were no Black faculty members. They either worked as cooks or people who cleaned the yards or whatever. But we have really made a lot of strides. And no, we're not there yet, but we'll get there if everybody tries to help us get there. Stop complaining so much and put your foot to the wheel. Get your degree and then become a good alumni so that you can help make University of Georgia better.
Amen. Amen. That deserves a round. I could sit up here and ask you questions all day. Last Friday, we had an opportunity to visit over Zoom, and it was supposed to be a 30-minute conversation. I think we talked for an hour and a half. So I definitely don't want to hog you. I'm going to turn it over to Jasmine Gresham, who has questions from our audience. But before I do, can you just speak to, because I think it's important, you talk a lot about roots and wings. Mm-hmm. Can you just really talk about what that means to you? And then we'll turn it over to Jasmine after that.
Roots are those things, you know, for a tree. A tree that has really strong roots can grow and prosper. Big trees like oaks. The root is the most important part of that tree, or the part of the flower, because it's what makes it grow. And my parents talked to us about the moral values that we should have, the fact that we should always do our best. All of those things represent roots to me. They were my foundation. And I have never strayed from them. Wings, I consider as being what we can do if we work to our potential. If we realize our own potential and then strive a little higher. I think it was at the documentary about me when I quoted The Impossible Dream, where it says to fight for the right without question or pause. You've got to be willing to put something in it to get something out. And so roots and wings are important because one keeps you grounded, the other takes you as far as you want to go.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Jasmine Gresham. I am a fourth-year health and physical education student in the Department of Kinesiology that is housed in the Mary Frances Early College of Education, named after Mary Frances Early herself. This is also my third year serving as a student ambassador in the college, so I'm very, very grateful to be here. I will be sharing the submissions for our question and answer portion of today's program, but before we begin, first, allow me to say thank you, Ms. Early and Coach Taylor, for such an engaging conversation. You have opened all of our eyes to what it means to be the first and how we can all put some steel in our backs to continue the legacy that you established 60 years ago. Coach Taylor, thank you for your thoughtfulness and asking those questions we all wanted to know. Ms. Early, on behalf of our current and future alumni, thank you for your commitment to excellence and for being a light on our path of higher education. I cannot express enough how much your contributions and sacrifices mean to me specifically. I am honored to stand on this stage as a Black woman beside the first to ever walk across the stage with a diploma in hand at this institution. So now, let's dive in and take questions submitted by both our virtual and live audience members. Our first question is, do you think we have achieved that ideal of being judged by the content of our character first yet? Why or why not?
Would you repeat that?
Yeah, of course. Do you think we have achieved that ideal of being judged by the content of our character first yet? Why or why not?
It depends upon who we're talking about. I think some people do and some people don't. Being judged by your character rather than by your appearance or the color of your skin is something that we should all do. But one of the problems with people of differing ethnic races, or ethnicities rather, is that they are afraid of people who are not like them. And all of us have been, I guess, looking at television and looking at the Afghans, of course, who've been expatriated here, and then the Haitians and people making comparisons. If we could strip the skin off everybody, we wouldn't know what color we were, would we? And I don't think we should have to do that. I think that we should use a bit of trust and think that a person, just because he's different from me, is probably okay, but I have to have the trust to find out. And I think that we should do this every day. It may be the person who comes to your door asking for help with a charity. It could be someone coming to your door asking for money to go to buy some food, whatever. But we are not there yet. In answer to your question, we are not at the point where we judge people by their characters rather than by the color of their skin.
Our second question is, how does it feel to see Black women like Dr. Michelle Cook and Coach Joni Taylor leading on a campus that you helped integrate?
It feels just wonderful. I am so proud of them. I am proud of the males too, so you won't be. Because there were no role models my color in terms of teachers. I've said that there were no professors, Black professors. But in 1968, I finished my second degree in 1967. And in 1968, we had a Black professor hired in the School of Music. I think he was hired first as a part-time person, but then he was hired as a full-time person, and then he became director of music for the music department, School of Music. That, to me, said a lot, because I had come as a music major in music education. And then for the first professor of color at UGA to be named just made me very, very proud. And it still makes me proud there is an organization of Black faculty members, and I spoke for them, I think, in 2019. And they bring a lot to the campus. You see, a lot of people want the Blacks on the athletic teams. Yeah, we need them on our football team, on our tennis team and swimming team. We need to stop thinking that only people who can do this are one color or the other, because they're Blacks who play golf. My father did not go to college. He was a golf enthusiast, and he tried to teach me how to play, but I didn't. I saw no sense in knocking the ball away and following it and knocking it away again. It didn't make sense. So what I'm saying is it doesn't have to do with who you are, but what appeals to you is what should be what makes you tick. And I think that as long as we look at people in terms of, well, you know, she's Black, she probably can't do this. You can't make one of the big mistakes I made when I was teaching. I had a young lady who was a flute player, and she was an average flute player. And I thought to myself, she will never make it any further than middle school. Well, she went on to high school, and she was the first flute player at her high school. And then I heard she was in New York, and she was in a small ensemble. And I thought, well, you were wrong on that one. You never know. You don't know what people can do. And you should never give people, you should never tell them that they can't do it, because you can do anything you want to do. But it makes me so proud. Joni Taylor she's a legend, and oh, she's not old enough to be one. But Dr. Cook, yes, one of the bravest people I know and smartest. And there are many others. I won't try to then. And the teacher I was talking about was Dr. Richard Graham. He was the first Black hired in 1968, and he was in music.
Well, as a Black student that is athletically challenged, I am very grateful to have other Black faculty on campus. And Coach Joni Taylor, I will not be joining your basketball team anytime soon. I'm so sorry. But I will be at every game that I can possibly make it to. And we have a question from our virtual audience. Someone said, I have not had a chance to read the book yet, but I wonder if you talk about a teacher who inspired you. If not, can you still share with us who that teacher was?
Yes. My seventh grade teacher at E.P. Johnson Elementary School was from Canada. Her grandparents had left the South on the Underground Railroad because they were slaves. And her parents raised her in Ontario, I think Canada. She heard and read about Spelman College and decided to come to America and to get her college education. She did. And she was our seventh grade teacher. She was a young teacher. We didn't have Black history, as is true today. We did not have Black history in our curriculum. But our teacher, Miss Willis, her name was Janae Willis. She was able to transform us into students who knew not only white poetry, but Black poetry. She's the one who taught us the pageant, Ethiopia at the Bar of Justice. She was a wonderful teacher, and I will never forget her.
All right, our next question. What advice do you have for 21st century trailblazers who continue to break down the barriers that still confront us? And they also said, thank you for blazing our trail.
Well, all I can say to the 21st century trailblazers is just keep going on. There is an old spiritual called keep your hands on the plow and roll on. And that's what you should do. Because we cannot sit on the sidelines and wait for somebody else to solve the problems for us, people. We have to all be part of it. So in a sense, we are all trailblazers. And I tell people all of the time, I have this name, the quiet trailblazer. I'm not always quiet. I try not to be ugly, but I'm not quiet when I feel that there's something that needs to be said. I just try to say it in a way that will not make people angry, hopefully. Because when people clash, nothing is solved. And we see that every day. But to the quiet trailblazers of today, just keep going on, because that is what will save our world.
Absolutely. And while we're speaking of trailblazers, it actually reminded me of when I was honored to win Homecoming Queen last year. I went to the main library. They have an exhibit now to celebrate 60th year of desegregation. And some of those trailblazers included the first UGA Homecoming, Black UGA Homecoming Queen and King and Queen, which were honored in 1995. And I had no idea who they were. So that was really amazing. And so our last question that we're going to take is, when other UGA trailblazers were being researched and recognized, why did you keep quiet?
Well, I guess it was part of my roots. My parents taught me that I should not blow my own horn. That may not be something that is taught today, but you never brag about yourself. Why would I talk about University of Georgia when they had forgotten me? Nobody would have believed me. And many of my students and a lot of teachers say, Ms. Early, you didn't tell us about what you did at UGA. They are just now finding out about it. But my goal was to be the best teacher that I could be. I wanted to be an inspiration to students. I didn't want to be known as just the lady who was the first to get a degree at the University of Georgia. I wanted to be known as a teacher who made a difference in my life. So that's why I didn't brag about it. I didn't talk about it because there was no point. I wasn't being recognized.
Well, I'm glad you're being recognized now. So, so thank you.
I am too.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us today to celebrate Miss Mary Frances Early and the launch of her autobiography, The Quiet Trailblazer, My Journey as the First Black Graduate of the University of Georgia. Members of the UGA community are invited to purchase The Quiet Trailblazer from the University of Georgia Press. Use code 0ATRBLAZ21 by October 15th to receive a 40% discount on the book and free shipping. The recording of today's event will be made available within the coming weeks. A big thank you to all the university partners that made today possible: the Office of the President, Mary Frances Early College of Education, UGA Libraries, UGA Press, and the Office of Alumni Relations. Of course, Joni Taylor, and the woman of the hour, Miss Mary Frances Early, thank you to you all as well. On behalf of the University of Georgia, thank you all. Congratulations again, Miss Early, on your autobiography, and go Dawgs!